and gentlemen, welcome to the annual Lawrence Lecture. Please join me in welcoming to the stage SWANA's International Board President, as of this morning, David Hornick, who will be introducing our speaker.
Good morning. Thank you. Good morning. Welcome to SWANA's Lawrence Lecture. Before introducing our speakers, I'd like to thank our sponsors, Cascade Cart Solutions and Environmental Solutions Group, who made this session possible. Let's give them a round of applause. Our speaker this morning is Bob Schoenberger. Dr. Schoenberger was appointed to the first Pennsylvania Solid Waste Advisory Committee in 1968 and oversaw the development of Pennsylvania's first solid waste management plan. During his career, he designed the first landfill asphalt liner and early leachate treatment systems in Pennsylvania and completed extensive work on hazardous waste issues and waste-to-energy plants. Dr. Schoenberger was appointed to the board of Chester County Solid Waste Authority, CCSWA, by the Chester County Commissioners in 2000. He took over the chairmanship of the CCSWA board in 2004 and still serves in that capacity. CCSWA has been recognized with awards by the SWANA Excellence Awards and the U.S. EPA Landfill Methane Outreach Program during his tenure. Dr. Schoenberger has long been an active member of SWANA, and in 2010, he received SWANA's Landfill Division Distinguished Individual Achievement Award. Dr. Schoenberger.
Thank you, David. Very honored to be here, and it's my privilege to be able to talk to you, my peers in the solid waste industry. And in that introduction are a couple of things I would like to acknowledge, and one of which is, yes, Chester County has done very well, but it's been due to Bob Watts, not me. So I have to recognize Bob for the great job that he's done. Kind of an irrefutable fact of life that time marches on. And as I was preparing this talk, I went through various titles. And the title that you see up here on the board is, or we'll see on the board. Got there. Nope, we're back. Wrong one. Okay. There it is. I thought that it would be a lot more selective in terms of not being confined to something very serious. solid waste shouldn't be serious. You know, solid waste is something that we deal with on a day-to-day basis. We've been the brunt of jokes for years. You know, we're not we're sanitary engineers. We're sanitation engineers. You know, we've had all kind of titles over the years. So I wanted to look at 60 years. It sounds like, well, that's a long time. That kind of predates me. My first job was in 1962. So I've actually been directly working in the field for 51 years. But I have a longer memory. So what I was saying about the time marches on, and I figured 51 years I've been in this business, my gosh, probably 60% of the audience out here wasn't even born yet. And probably at least 25%, you know, aren't even familiar, when I talk about my middle career, let's say 85 to 90, 25-35% of the people were not born. So this is kind of a walk back in time, and we've come a long way. And one of the great rides that I've been on is being there and part of it, and seeing how we have moved forward, how we've changed, how we've improved, how we protect the environment, how we continue to move forward, and how we need to continue to move forward. So with that, let me go on and start the talk. Back in 1972, okay. Green one. There we go. Solid waste hasn't always been serious. So BC, who isn't even, I guess, in the comics anymore, has a visitor, visits Peter's Pollution Control Center. He says, sometimes, why? He says, my garbage is out of control. So in the 70s, it probably was out of control. Come on. What was solid waste? We started out with some very simple definitions. Refuse, trash, garbage, useless unwanted materials, not wet enough to be free flowing. So Pennsylvania, not to be outdone, they expanded a little bit. Waste including but not limited to municipal, residential, residual, hazardous waste, including solid, liquid, semi-solid, contained, gaseous materials. So it includes everything under the sun. And I guess this is kind of the basis for a very comprehensive set of regulations that eventually came forward under RACRA. And this is where we were. Some open burning landfills. And there wasn't a whole lot more in terms of our waste management system. When I take a look at what happened and what changed through all of this, I realize that there were probably five seminal moments in the last couple of years. Before I talk about this, there is one that I have listed here that is not directly related to solid waste, but has to deal with the environment in general. And it's probably an obscure change in the way things were done that occurred in 1965. In 1965, all of the programs, air, water, waste, were in the United States Public Health Service under the Office of the Surgeon General. But in 1965, Lyndon Johnson moved the water programs over to the Department of the Interior. And up until that time, the programs were advisory. They had voluntary drinking water standards, for example, but they were not mandatory drinking water standards. The states were still the preeminent programs for enforcement and protection of the environment. But in 1965, the federal government, under that movement by President Johnson, the federal government started to take charge and to issue standards nationwide. And subsequently, these laws that you have before you here, the 1965 Solid Waste Act, which was Title II, but Title I was the Resource Conservation Recovery Act. the Clean Air Act of 67, Clean Air Act then of 77 amendments, Clean Water Act. There was a Clean Water Act in 65 that also, right after it was moved, that took some of the regulations and started to put them nationwide, and then RCRA. But the last item there is the state of California. We've always heard about how the state of California is frequently at the forefront of knowledge. And the state of California was truly at the forefront with this three publications that they put out in the early 1960s under a contract with Engineering Science. So let's take a look at some of the acts. We'll briefly go through them. The Solid Waste Act, this is what it did. It did not issue standards. It did not issue regulations. But it authorized a dedicated program for solid waste management within the Public Health Service. It provided funding for the technology and operating of protective demonstrations. That is a critical one because that is where many of the technology aspects arose. It established graduate level programs in solid waste management. I was privileged to have one of the first five at Drexel University. And we had five traineeships and established a master's degree program in solid waste management. And it did provide for the funding for academic research on solid waste issues. Clean Air Act, it was very far-reaching, and it caused a lot of units to close. It allowed programs to be established at the local level, and it established emission standards. Heretofore, the emission standards were very minimal, and largely they were under the American Society of Mechanical Engineers Power Test Code 30, and that the Clean Air Act kind of leapfrogged all of the ASME codes. And those of us who were in the field at the time, we know that I was very active in ASME and in the incinerator division. And it was a give and tuck battle with the government over what role did the power test code and the existing regulations play. And what happened with the Clean Air Act and the stress that it put on closing of many of the existing units was that it did forge the construction and formed the basis for waste energy incinerators, waste energy units, I shouldn't call them incinerators, that were then built in this time frame beginning in the 70 to 95 time frame. Clean Water Act. Clean Water Act is one of those things that had a lot of unintended consequences. It started to put restrictions on permits. It established permits at the federal level, the NPDS, National Pollution Discharge Elimination System. These did not exist before. All of the permits were at the state level and were enforced and operated by the states. What the federal program did is it eliminated a lot of industrial waste, primarily the liquids and the sludges, and solvents and oils and greases that were put into the sewer systems. And it says, you can't do this. And where did they go? Almost without failure, most of them wound up in landfills. And we went through a 10-year period somewhere between 1965 and 1975, where tremendous amounts of liquids were put into landfills, some in drums, some in just in uncontained roll-off materials from trucks, vans. So It was quite a time in there trying to wrestle with that. RCRA, Of all of the laws that were passed in the 20th century, RCRA had the most impact on environmental activities of any of the acts. It was the first act that moved away from the top of the stack or the discharge at the end of a pipe and moved it up into the plant and talked about how to manage your waste in the plant, how to eliminate waste, how to control it, how to keep track of it. And it created a hierarchy of toxicity. You know, it had several different criteria in there, including extreme toxic and just general toxic, and then a third one, which was dealing with testing for toxicity. So it was a brand new approach. And the purpose of RCRA, of course, was to provide title to the grave control. One of the parts of RCRA, I mean, it was divided into 11 different sections, but subtitle C was for hazardous waste, subtitle D was for solid waste. And it was from subtitle D that we eventually evolved. It took quite a while. RCRA was passed in 76, until 89, until the requirements for the liner system and the double liners and the leachate management systems became required. So RCRA had that as an offshoot, but the other parts of RCRA dealing with hazardous waste were equally as impacting the solid waste industry. Landfill criteria in 1960 were very simple. You know, when I worked for the Department of Health was, don't burn it if there's anybody that lives nearby and it creates a nuisance. Cover it occasionally if it smells. That was it. And one other thing that was, you know, didn't want to eliminate the use of rats for target practice, so that we had to be careful and maintain that that population. These are the three publications from the state of California, and this was the first time that we started to recognize the movement of liquids, movement of gases, and tried to be concerned with groundwater. I remember going to several of the conferences Public Health Service put on, trying to get people aware of RCRA, or, I mean, of the Solid Waste Act in 1965. And those of us who had programs that they funded went and were invited to these programs. There was one that was in Columbus in fall of 1965, and one of the speakers there, Ralph Black, who was with the Public Health Service at the time, who had come from California, and I distinctly remember him saying that as long as you put daily cover on and you compacted the waste and didn't burn, that landfills were not going to give you any problems. There was not going to be any residual contamination, any movement off-site. And at that time, for about a year, that was very much the thoughts at the time. It did begin to change as data started to come in. And we realized that, yes, landfills did have the potential for impacting primarily groundwater, but also surface water if you did not have the proper runoff controls. There had been some studies before. This was a seminal one published by the British government in 1954 that dealt with leachate. But in 1965, this was the Bible. If you wanted to know what was the state of solid waste management, this is where everybody went. American Public Works Association. The American Public Works Association at that time was the delegate to the International Solid Waste Association. And it was the, as I said, it was the Bible. And it was divided into several chapters, and this is what they looked at as defining solid waste management. They did start off with sanitary landfills, to their credit. And probably in 1965, the number of sanitary landfills in the United States, you could count on, you know, well, you may have to use all your toes and fingers, but that was about it. Once you got out of California, there were very few what we would know today as sanitary landfills. And there were none with any liners, any groundwater protection systems. And it was the beginning of us starting to look at how to engineer a landfill in order to protect the environment. They differentiated central incineration from site incineration. Central incineration being large plants. I remember I had a research grant from the Public Health Service to look at residue from incinerators. And the purpose was to try and define what constitutes good burnout. The only criteria that was used was basically loss on ignition. And I used to joke that out of the Philadelphia incinerators, the best way to measure it was to just to look at it and count the number of colors, because it only burned about 50% of the material, and you can see the oranges and the bananas and the grass and the melons, and you know, it was a multicolored mixture, and it was a good example of trying to see how well things were. These were incinerators that were batch feed, and they just simply were designed for purposes other than protecting the environment and reducing the volume of waste. They said before in 65, almost all of the landfills were called dumps, and they were open burning, largely uncontrolled. And to give you some idea of what the magnitude of the problem was, after the solid waste program moved out of the Public Health Service, a program was established that was called Operation 39,000. And the purpose was to close 39,000 open dumps in some limited period of time. This was the number of dumps that were out there and in operation at that time. In 1968, Pennsylvania passed the first Solid Waste Act. They had no requirements up until that time. And in that particular act, with the committee that was formed, Pennsylvania has strange political subdivisions. You know, there's boroughs and cities, and there's 2,800 separate municipalities within the state of Pennsylvania. And in 1970, there was 1,800 dumps. So when you take a look at the city of Philadelphia had incinerators, Pittsburgh had incinerators, Allentown had an incinerator, most of the ring counties in and around Philadelphia had incinerators, so that you can just know that in the rest of the state, you had this large number of open burning dumps. And the first thing that was done was to at least stop the burning and then gradually move into closures and cover and then to daily cover. And eventually You know, it takes 10, 15 years, but you can move in that direction. And it takes a while, but eventually you evolve a real workable and solid solid waste management system. Incineration in the 1960s, very poor. And it was guided by the Incinerator Institute of America. And it's interesting because if you take a look at the Incinerator Institute of America's standards at that time, they defined solid waste as the combination of garbage and refuse. And it's always been in those early years that what we know as solid waste today was comprised of garbage and refuse, or garbage and trash. And even to this day, I keep thinking people that refer to solid waste as garbage are only referring to a portion of the solid waste. They're not talking about all of the material that comprise solid waste. Anyway, these were standards. Again, there were no criteria that said this is how well you should burn. All it said was if you have, there were six categories of waste. If you fell into category two, this is the kind of incinerator that you could use and try to do some preliminary things such as defining the length of burning time and residence time for burnout, but it didn't go beyond any of that. Had no effluent criteria, had no emission criteria, had nothing that talked about how to handle the ash, how to dispose of the ash. It simply was an incinerator. I taught a course several times. The Public Health Service put these courses on in various programs. Incineration was starting to come into much more general use as we took a look at solid waste management and realized that landfills were not the answer. So just in summary there, in 1960, most of them were small batch units and there was no energy recovery. 1960, this was as good as it got. This was Chicago Northwest Incinerator, and there was a twin to this in the city of Philadelphia that was called the Northwest Incinerator, and then a second one called the East Central Incinerator. And it consisted of material that was put onto traveling great stokers, and it gave you a much better burnout, much more controlled, and it did have a few air pollution control devices. You know, it had a subsidence chamber, and it had a water spray before it went out into the stack. So you were probably able to meet a code of maybe 10 times what ultimately evolved as the emission standard for municipal waste combustor units. Middle years, what happens? Things were, dumps were closed. We made a lot of progress across the country, some states faster than others. But probably one of the most important things was the evolution then of waste to energy. And waste to energy was driven a lot by the 1973 problems with the oil embargoes and the rise in cost of fuel. And fuel in 1973 had almost a 200% increase in basic cost. I remember that number six oil, for example, that was used in most of the power plants that burned oil would be selling for, you know, 4.5, 5 cents a gallon, and all of a sudden it went to 20 cents a gallon. And this was putting great stress onto the cost of electricity and energy. And waste energy plants said, wow, you know, we can fill some of this void in here. We have all of this material that contains BTUs. We can make energy from our units. So we had quite a few of them that were constructed, and most of them operated reasonably well and served their intended purpose. A lot of the batch units were closed, incinerators were closed, and we just had all kind of technology proposals coming out of the woodwork. Many of the activities that we're talking about today, the plasma arc, actually came in, you know, in this time frame, coming out of Queen's College in Ontario. I don't know if they still hold that patent or not. And there was a whole bunch of these, and we'll talk about them in a little bit. But lastly, we did use lots of papers. We published lots of reports, and we did move ahead. So, you know, some of the reports that came out, this was one that the Public Health Service put out. At this time, it was the EPA, and it was the preliminary design and operation. And then, 1977, the first gas concerns started to arise. Why are we producing gas? What is gas doing? And it's been an uphill ride ever since. As we have controlled leachate and other environmental factors with proper operation of landfills, and gas still is the one item that we're struggling to get totally control over. There was a whole bunch of waste processing reports, state of the art, research, and then later on in the mid-1970s, the National Academy of Science put out a report called Waste Management Control that they should have been ashamed of. It was a real repeat of nothing that didn't take us any place in where we're going in waste management. One of the other things that came into play in this time era was the American Chemical Society started a new publication. And Environmental Science and Technology magazine, which became a very, very high-level peer-reviewed journal in that period of time. And some of the things that I have taken here are from that. So in this time period, we started to codify landfills. We identified gas, landfill gas as something of concern. And the search for leachate management begins. And I say it begins because in 2013, I'm not sure that we have solved the leachate question yet. Landfills evolved. Thou shalt compact. Thou shalt do it on a slope. Thou shalt create cells. Thou shalt operate a landfill in an environmentally acceptable manner. Define it. This, to me, was one of the most far-reaching publications that came out of the research that the EPA funded. This is the report by my colleague, Dr. Fred Pullen at Georgia Tech. And it is the basis for what we know today as bioreactor landfills and resource recovery from landfills. And I think, if anything, we probably can give Fred Pullen the title of the father of the bioreactor landfill, because it was his work that has set the stage for what we are doing today. And finally, you know, today it is starting to alter the way we are taking a look at landfills. One of the things, for example, last week at the Keystone Chapter conference, mini tech seminars, my Drexel colleague, Dr. Bob Kerner, who you all know from the Geosynthetics Institute, issued two statements that he thought we ought to be considering. He said, one of them, we need, after 40 years, to go back and take a look at the criteria that we use for landfilling and see if it is accomplishing what we want it to accomplish or whether we ought to be doing it better. One of which, he says, we take a look at the two liner systems, and we always put the better liner system on the top and our secondary liner system on the bottom. He said, wouldn't it make more sense to turn those around and put our less stringent liner on the top and put our more stringent liner down where it does protect the environment? So it is a, it is a thought. And the other challenge that he threw out, he says, I'm still looking for somebody to show me the landowner who has been saved by migration of leachate by down gradient wells. He says, perhaps we need to rethink how we monitor landfills, that the all of the money that's expended on monitoring does not appear to be proving its net worth. And I know from my own personal point of view, at Lanchester, Pennsylvania requires us to monitor quarterly all of the contiguous landowners, plus all of the monitoring wells on site. So on a quarterly basis, we monitor in excess of 80 wells, and have been doing that for 15 plus years. So we certainly know a lot. We know that quality isn't moving around, and there's certainly a lot of potential to revisit onerous regulations like that. Okay. What was the solution in 1970? It's going to be thermal. Although, well, I'll call it fractionation, we might call it separation, source separation. Those were the proposals that we were going to follow in the future. 1970, the aerospace industry came out of the woodworks, and they told us about all of these wonderful systems that they had, and that these guys knew what they were doing. They were engineers, and they were putting a man on the moon, and trash was nothing. I mean, they had all the answers. And has anybody seen a CPU 400? Yeah, I guess not. Anyway, we evolved a whole bunch of gasification, I'll call them pyrolysis technologies. And these are some of them that were going to be tomorrow's technology today. And some of them were from European origin. Some of them were companies who were trying to sell a product like the enriched oxygen units. And then you had some like Monsanto, and the Landguard process, where they built this facility in Baltimore, and it was to be a partial pyrolysis system, partial gasification system. And they scaled it up, from a 55-gallon bucket to 40-ton-an-hour unit, and it just didn't work. So, matter of fact, there are none of these technologies from 1975 that ever made it to commercialization. Doesn't mean that someday they won't, but as of right now, they have not. So this is the compilation of the technology differences that we're looking at today versus they were in 1970. Not a whole lot. We're still beating the same horses and trying to win that race. We did get, you know, some programs that we're looking at fractionation. You know, the Bureau of Mines, I heard John talk of that. He worked on that project. You know, was well known. They had this this program of separating things, and it was really a pretty forward-looking program. Unfortunately, you know, a lot of the technology hadn't caught up with it. But this is the one that was out of Delaware. And I didn't see Pat Canzano here. Pat Canzano was working for Hercules at the time. And the interesting thing was that this particular proposal was a private sector proposal by a manufacturer of explosives, Hercules Corporation. And they were going to build this wonderful facility that was able to take solid waste and separate it into components, process it, recover energy, treat it jointly with the sewage sludge from a wastewater treatment plant there. And it was a pretty extensive program. And their front end processing looked something like this. It had 27 separate binary separation schemes. Yeah, you knew pretty well when you're saying, I've got 27 systems that all have to work in uniform, and if any one of them goes down, the system breaks down, that you're in trouble. They were in trouble. Recycling, recovery, reuse. It had early roots, but it didn't get more organized until quite a bit later, as most of the effort was put into landfilling, thermal processing, fractionation, anaerobic digestion, composting, you know, basically end treatment technologies. 1964, Coke and Pepsi were delivered in 6-ounce bottles. And when you went and you bought a 6-pack of them, you paid 2 cents a bottle for a deposit. If you got the quart bottles, you know, it was 5 cents. Today, that doesn't sound like a lot of money. But remember, 2 cents in 1954 is equivalent to almost 50 cents today. So that we, if we were charging the same amount on a deposit, that's what it would be today. So it's a very substantial amount. I remember when you bought soda or you bought beer, you bought it in returnable bottles and you paid that deposit. So we had recycling that went on. Newspapers still had worth, and that was one of the favorite fundraising activities of Boy Scouts. And there wasn't much else that we recovered out of the waste stream. It was the bottles that had value, and it was the newspapers. We take a look at the recycling and recovery in 1960 and compare it to what is in the waste stream today that we recover that may have some value, and we see that things have changed. You know, ferrous, for example, is still there, but it's there in a different form in 2013 than it was in 1960. One of the programs that was funded by Public Health Service was a system that to a company called Americology. And Americology was a arm of American Can Company, and what they wanted to do was they wanted to get the tin off of the ferrous cans that were in the waste stream in the late 1960s, early 1970s. So they evolved this system whereby they would be able to separate out the ferrous metals. Unfortunately, aluminum arrived on the scene and pretty much put an end to what was a very valid system, but just mistimed. Not too many tin cans today. You know, you have a metal can, it's all polymer coatings. We don't use tin cans anymore. Natural rubber, there was a lot of value to natural rubber, and it was recovered. It doesn't exist in our waste stream anymore, but we do have rubber, now we have tires, and now we're saddled with, you know, how do we handle tires? Because we don't want them in the landfills. They are capable of being burned in the waste to energy units, but it still leaves a lot of tires that we keep trying to find ways of utilizing them. And the difficulty is they're so difficult and costly to process in order to make them into reusable products. We had a lot of glass. 1960, we still have glass, we still recover glass. I had a project with a beverage institute to look at, is there going to be any problem with leaching of contaminants from glass? They were very, very concerned about that, and they were concerned that any leaching from glass was going to wind up in landfills and in the leachate. That was their concern. They didn't want to be saddled with somebody coming back and say, you've got to provide us with assistance in treating leachate. But it turns out that all of the glasses are just almost totally free of any type of leaching. I subsequently did a project for Corning Glass that in Bluffton, Indiana, where they were making picture tubes, and everybody keeps worrying about picture tubes and the 22% lead that's in the glass, and does it leach? And they had seven lagoons there that had the glass that came from the lapping and the final polishing operations. This was glass that was extremely fine particles coming off of there. Those lagoons did cause contamination of the groundwater, but not from lead and not from the glass. It only came from the lapping solutions, the solvents and the oils and greases that were used. That was what migrated. So I've concluded over the years that contamination from glass and it being of environmental concern is one of those myths that ultimately we ought to put to bed. Okay, wood and C&D rubble, food waste, and vegetation we still have. And in 1960, we didn't do a whole lot with them, but in 2013, you know, it is one of our biggest sources of waste diversion away from landfills. So we can look at a quick timeline for recycling. You know, we had very minimal source separation in the early years, and we didn't have any treatment. We had a lot of on-site treatment, but we didn't have any mass processing. We started to go to curbside collection in the middle years, and we also went to some other niches, you know, such as composting, and eventually, we've evolved to where we are today, and I think in the recycling industry, we're somewhat at a crossroads. We are getting a lot of diversion, and we're doing a great job of that. We're doing some additional recycling for many of the low-hanging fruit, the aluminum in particular that has value, glass that has almost no value. So we are trying to search for how do we get the best out of that waste stream. And I think that one of the things that we need to do is we need to recognize that recycling is not a field of its own. Landfilling is not a field of its own. What we need to do is we need a system, an overall system that takes a look at the whole solid waste picture. We're always going to need landfilling for some components, but how do we best treat that? How do we handle landfills as a source for separation and being able to manage those materials that do have some economic value? So briefly, the major thing that has changed, and as we look at the amount of material that has been recovered from the waste streams going back over the last 50 years, and we find that it is a very substantial amount. You know, newspaper, for example, is the amount that we're recovering is very high. Getting a good percentage out of it, the metal, the other metals, besides aluminum, is a.
Bob, we've got about 5 minutes left.
Okay.
Please wrap it up.
Okay. So. Composting, there are a lot of proposals and a lot of failures. I think composting still has some potential, but we're starting to look at it more selectively by taking the niche materials. And that's the way that we need to go with composting. What are we missing? Why have we gotten to where we are? We've probably made a lot of mistakes in technology, but we've also made a lot of mistakes in economics. Today, this is where we are. Sanitary landfills dominate. The waste-to-energy fleet is aging. Some of it is being shut down. Recycling is moving along. And composting is still a very minor player. Why haven't we done better? I think we haven't done better for this reason. If we take a look at these materials and technology evaluations, we haven't scaled up properly. There is a certain way that you must go, yet you've got to scale up. And we've tended to get more complex, we've tended to overreach, and we've tended to avoid cost and cost containment. And we've got to continue to do that. So. My predictions for the future. We're going to continue to try to define what is landfill closure. We still don't know. You know, we arbitrarily said it's going to be 30 years. Yeah. That's proving not to be a usable criteria. Secondary materials markets are cyclical. They're going to continue to be cyclical. We must recognize that they're cyclical. And we need to move ahead with our recycling and recovery programs that somehow take into account that the cyclical cycles. Cost of solid waste management is not going to decrease. We heard it the other day about potentials for new bans, for new taxes. That's going to increase the cost of waste disposal. And just bear in mind, the more complex we make the system through diversion of products and product stewardship and waste bans, the overall cost is going to continue to rise. That's not going to be a way to decrease solid waste costs. So with that, I just want to say one thing. This is a clock, tire clock. That's been in operation for 150 years. It's very simple. It runs off of three gears, one for an hour, one for a minute, one for a second. It's simple. And sometimes something happens in a field where it is turned upside down. And the quartz crystal was one of those. It turned the clock industry upside down, where we could get within a couple of minutes a month. Now we can get within a couple tenths of a second a month in accuracy for less than 50 cents on a crystal. My thought for the future, keep it simple. Stay away from the complex. My office is open. Come and talk to me. And one last prediction. Toronto will issue a proposal in 2030 for a pyrolysis project.
Thank you, Bob. Very interesting.